Hi Marc. Okay, things to pay attention here is software categories in the POSI software stack. So we have software already installed, ready to use by by researchers. What are a module system and a module and why they are useful? So as you may be wondering, the software is organized in this kind of grouping called modules. So you need to learn how to use the module command. And yeah, module command and a series of subcommands to basically check for the software that is available and use it. So we call the software stack to all the software that we have already installed in POSI. So we don't install everything for the users. We basically, as some software is used by many users, then it becomes very common, and then that's the software we decide to install. So there's a lot of software that is pretty common. But there is some other pieces of software that are installed only project by project or even user by user. And usually it is the user that does those installations. So there is a lot of different kind of software. So we have the compilers, which basically create the executables to run in supercomputer, and these are development tools. So while you usually don't need the compiler for a single time. Usually, when you are developing your code, you compile many times and you make cycles with debuggers and profilers to see how efficient is your code, where are the problems in your code, and also the use of several libraries that are already optimized and to include them in your code. All these come together. This usually is provided by the vendor. So HPE Cray provides these compilers, libraries, and tools. So that comes from them as when we bought the computer. So then we have some other pieces of software that are containers or are called containers. So we provide this. These are not provided by the vendor, not provided by Cray. And we also install software directly in the supercomputer. These are the scientific software modules that we provide. So there is a special model for containers that we can talk about this later, but the point of the containers is that the installation of the software itself is not does not reside in the file systems of Setonix. It resides inside these things that are called containers. So basically are sort of virtual machines that have their own installation of software and can be used in Setonix. So the place we are installing software is in software Setonix and below that directory. So that's the reason why we have also software projects and your user directory for you to install things. But this place is reserved for us to install things and software projects. Yeah, and this is the place. I'm sorry, in software Setonix, and these are the other places where you installed your own stuff in software projects and your project ID. Okay. There is one tool called SPAC that we use it a lot here to install our own software stack. Well, not our own, the software stack that we support for the users. And it has become a very common tool for installations in supercomputing facilities. It was developed by one of the national labs in the US, specifically for this. So it is the recommended tool for installation of pieces of software that you may need. Another recommended source of software that you may need, you can find it already included in some containers. So the point of this is that you can grab the containers and use them at POSI with the installation coming inside the containers. For Python and R, we recommend to install them through pip or the R package manager or Conda. Anyway, we are open to any kind of way of installing your own stuff with basically the main restriction is your quota limits in software. And it's not specified here, but not to use the login nodes for installations, but to basically use the compute nodes for that. Okay, now the title of this part is software modules and why do we need modules? It is basically, it's not that we need them. It is a solution that a long time ago, people decided to use to organize the software in a big computer that is shared by many users. So, all the software is available to everyone, but it doesn't make sense to make it is a huge list of software packages available. So it doesn't make sense to make them all available by default to everyone. That will generate a huge path definitions for all the users, etc. So it's a problem to have everything available to everyone. So that's why they decided to use this idea of modules. So then the user asks what they need and load that module, and then that software becomes available to you. So all the modules are available to everyone, but the software itself is not available until the module is loaded. And in this way, you can organize things and load only what you need. And also, the modules also modifies the environment so that you can use the software with some environment variables specifically for the software in those modules to work. Okay. So there are, I guess, some different technologies, if I can say, to organize modules. And in this case, we use LMOD, LMOD module system. And basically, it's just an organization of the pieces of software that are available. So this is the first demo. What is available? Okay. So module. There are some defaults that are initially available to the users as they log in. So it's not completely blank. So there are several modules already loaded. So these are the current loaded modules. So names are a bit strange, but what we can see is that there is a module for the Lib Fabric, which is the interconnections between nodes. So it uses many libraries, etc. So those libraries are loaded by default to the user. Then, for example, the default is this programming environment, the programming environment from GNU. which has the GCC compiler and G-Fortran compiler, etc. For example, this one for the scheduler, SLURM 22. So that those pieces are already available to the user. But nothing, if I can say, nothing like a, I don't know, a software to solve fluid mechanics or chemistry, etc. So there are many others available. So for that, we can do module, a vial. And this one is a long list. Just thinking. This long list, some models provided by Cray. Here they are. So this is our organization. So this, all these modules are for astronomy applications. Here are some modules for bioinformatics. Here are some other modules for general applications. For example, this one for fluid mechanics, Gromax, LAMPS for material sciences and chemistry, etc. Some libraries for HDF5. These libraries, well, these are libraries of everything. HDF5 is for storing data in a parallel framework. PET-C is a scientific library for numerical pieces of software. So to go down, you need to do the space bar. So with the space bar, there you see everything that is there. So probably a bit difficult to see how much is there. So in our documentation, we also have a list of software that is available. It's more readable. So you need to go through both of the commands. So the module available and both ways, our documentation and module available. So for example, if in our documentation you saw this OpenFOAM software that is for fluid dynamics, and now you want to know what module to load, you can do module available and then OpenFOAM. So with that, you restrict sort of the search of the availability of that kind of software. So with module available OpenFOAM, you can see all the different modules that are available, the different versions of OpenFOAM that we have ready for users to use, and then decide which module to use. So in this case, let's say I want to use the OpenFOAM 2206. So then, just to let you know, one of the commands of OpenFOAM is, for example, icofoam. If I do icofoam help, that command is not found. But if I do the module load OpenFOAM 2206, and then I can do module list, and then you can see in that list, just the loading of OpenFOAM 2206 probably loaded many other modules, but it's also loading, or the one that is important, it's loading OpenFOAM 2206. That's the one I want to see loaded. So if it's there, the icofoam command should work. So now it works, it finds the icofoam just when loading the module. And if I unload, then the command is not there anymore. So Tonex is a bit slow. So that's the idea of the modules. I guess with this brief demo, you should be able to get the idea. You can load or unload modules to make available or not available different pieces of software. So there is a result of module list and the result of module avail. You already saw it. So a bit of the description of the modules, the program environment module, program environment GNU is the one that is loaded by default, and it has the compilers GCC, GFORTRAN, etc. If you want to use the compilers provided by Cray, Cray has a long history of creating compilers that generate code very optimized for their own computers. So this programming environment is very good. I use it a lot. So you can compile programs with this is the compiler in C, CCE, for the Cray programming environment. And also there is the Cray Fortran available. AMD, which is the hardware developer of the CPUs and the GPUs we have in Cetonix, also provides their own programming environment and their own compilers. Currently, these ones are not working very well, so these two programming environments are the ones that we are recommending users to use. Okay, the MPA library comes in the Cray mPitch module, and oops, also some other libraries specific for the architecture, for example, for using the chips, the AMD chips in the CPU nodes. Cray P-X86 Milan is the module that should be loaded. For using the GPUs, you should be loading this module for correct compilation of software and correct usage of software in the GPU nodes. So there is no escape. Once you are going to use something in the supercomputer, you will be loading some modules pretty much all the time. So we did the module avail without arguments and gave us a huge list. If you do module avail with a name, it will give you a list specifically for the software you are looking for. So we already did the module load and the module unload of the OpenFOAM example. In this case, there is an example. So it's basically the same kind of command. So they said, which NWChem? And the response is, there is no NWChem. I cannot see any NWChem here. So then load the NWChem 702 and module list, and you can see the NWChem is there. And now, if you do which NWChem, it will give you the path where the executable NWChem resides. In this case, as you can see, this one is an installation that comes from using SPAC. So below software Cetonix, in this case, this NWChem was installed along all these subdirectories. So this installation was done in this year. Then using I don't know some specifics of that installation. It was an installation that was optimized for the Zen 3 AMD chips, an installation that used GCC compiler to compile, an installation that used this version of NWChem. Then this large string is given by SPAC itself. And then finally, you reach the executable. So that's where the executable is. So the thing is that when you do the module load NWChem, all the paths in your environment are set so that you can see the NWChem executable with simply doing nwchem. You don't need to provide all the paths to it. So that's the idea of the modules. So here is an exercise. So basically, please try to do it. Questions are 1 to 8. Try to check how many Gromax versions are available in the module, in the available modules. Yeah, this is for you to check for some other code that you may want it to be available. Check if it's there as a module. This is a question about the CMake, which versions are available. First, when you log in, and then available through a module. So yeah, there is one CMake by default, but there are some other models of CMake. Okay, so this is the thing. And question 5 is to load a module without the version. So I can do that here. So I loaded OpenFOAM saying the version, but if I do module load OpenFOAM without a version, I receive an error. So we did that because users were defining their scripts and then saying, I'm going to load, let's say, OpenFOAM, but there were different versions of OpenFOAM. Or when we change the versions of OpenFOAM for after a maintenance, etc., then the scripts break and we couldn't figure out easily what was happening. So the idea with forcing you to specify the version is that now we are certain that your script worked for that specific version, and if it's failing somehow with that specific version, the problem comes from somewhere else. What I mean is it reduces the chances or the possibilities when something goes wrong to figure out what is happening. So basically, we are forcing users to always use the version number of the modules. That version comes after the slash. So this is the name of the module, and then this is the version number. Without the version number, the module doesn't load, but with the version number, it loads. So that's question 5 and 6. Okay. Yeah, so we'll make the slides available to you guys, I guess by the end of the day. Some module a bio to make. Yeah, there is another CMake there. CMake. Different from the default version that comes as a login by default. So module list. So this CMake default does not come as part of any module. So that is an installation that is not from a module. It comes with the operating system itself. That's CMake. There's also a Python. There's also a Python that comes with the operating system itself by default. Oh no, I have a module loaded, so module unload. It was because of the open form. For unloading, you don't need to specify the version, so you can module unload open form. Then that Python goes away, and if I type Python, oh no. Okay, so no. There's no Python version with the operating system. Okay. But CMake, there was. Okay, so again, if you went through all the exercise, Grommax, probably this is not up to date. Probably the numbers you saw are different, that was when the slides were done. So these are the Grommax versions that were available. This was the CMake version that was available at that time. And when you do the modular by CMake, yeah, there's one more. If you load CMake without version, you get an error. So you need to specify the version. And now after loading, the version changes. This was the default. This is now the one to be used. Compiler dependency. So now let's go. Yeah, okay. So some software available in the modules depends on the environment of the compiler that was used for compiling them. So if you saw the NWChem that was compiled with the GNU compilers. So here's a demo. Yeah. Yeah, so let's do the demo with the NWChem. Yeah, so module file NWChem. If I do module load NWChem 7.2.0. So if you see the programming environment that is loaded is the GNU programming environment, and this is the NWChem module that is available. So in the demo, there was this switch, NWChem. Yeah. But if I change the programming environment, module swap, programming environment GNU programming environment Cray. What happened was that NWChem is not available being compiled with the Cray compilers. So it's only available when compiled with the GNU compiler. So this command, the swap command, changes a module to another module. In this case, I'm changing this very important module, which is the programming environment, to use another programming environment, which is the programming environment provided with the Cray compilers. So when you do this kind of swap, some of the software that was originally available at some point may not be available anymore because that software was not compiled with that programming environment. So if you see now, after doing the swap, GCC is being replaced with the CCE compiler, and now some modules are inactive that were already loaded. So these modules, probably they were only compiled with the GNU compiler. So let's see what the, does the which command do. Yeah, so there's no NWChem in this available path. So all this path is the path that has been set by the programming environment to look for things, to look for executables when I use the programming environment Cray. So yeah, ideally what should be done, but we are not going to do that with all pieces of software, but probably with some important pieces of software, they should be compiled with the different programming environments. So when you change programming environment, the tool still be available with the other programming environment, in this case with the programming environment of Cray. So this is the thing. So this swap command is very common when developing code. Many developers prefer the Cray compilers over the GNU compilers. So basically, this can be like the first module step, changing programming environment to use Cray. But with that, some modules will not be available. But I guess it wouldn't matter if they are developing their own codes. So now, if we swap back from program environment K to program environment GNU, then it sends a message that these modules are active again. So the NWChem is active again. Now, one thing is that the module, if you do module avail programming environment, you will see that these modules also have a version. And I'm not using the version here because we cannot mess up with the modules that are being provided by the vendor, by Cray directly. So we couldn't put that strict rule of the versioning on those modules. So we cannot touch them because they are supporting them for us and for the users. And if there is any problem with them, we can ask them, okay, these modules have a problem. But the only, well, one of the rules they put to give support to what they provide is that we don't touch it. So they provide it, they support it, we can complain, we can tell them what is going wrong and they will help us, but we cannot make any changes. In this case, we cannot force to use the versions. So these specific modules that are provided by Cray, you don't need the version. So if you do load instead of swap, you can load it without versioning. And this loading and swapping, I think, do exactly the same. But swap is more illustrative of what you are doing because you are changing one programming environment for another one, or you are changing one model for another one. And rather, instead, load is telling I'm loading a new module. But yeah, that's the use of swap. Okay, this demo is exactly. Ah, here is the demo for NWChem. So NWChem, swapping the modules, no NWChem available. So there are some other commands: module list, module available string, module load name version, module unload name version, but for unloading, you can skip the version and module swap. These commands are the ones that we learned today. Yeah, module what is gives you some text that is already included in the module information. So if you do module what is a module, it will tell you something about it. And module help module, yeah, it will show help information for that module. In our other supercomputers, modules are similar. Yeah, I guess here what it's saying is that there are a few, not the same modules. Modules are different, but the idea is exactly the same. If you get to use some other of our supercomputers. Okay, so this is important. We don't have software that is needs to be paid for use. So we don't have licensed software. We don't provide it. So if you have your own licensed software, you need to provide it and install it yourself. So all the software that we provide is open source, and we have installed it and compiled it in the best optimized way we could for using Cetonix. Yeah, and we can provide assistance for installing software, but yeah, there is sort of some kind of priorities. Officially, each user or each project is responsible to install any kind of software that they need for the research. But for sure, we are all the time helping to install software to many users for their own projects.